So very good evening to all. Welcome to this ICA webinar in the ICA webinar series. Welcome for today's module. I would request Dr. B. Radhakrishnan to take over further for today's webinar. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good evening and welcome all to Indian College of Anesthesiologists. We are signing in to our Wednesday evening webinar. Well, thank you for your support for the 14th July session, which was our 1 year culmination program. This is our second year of continuous webinar, and we will have certain changes this year to make it more appreciable as well as more academic for all the people who are listening, whether you are a student or a junior faculty or a senior faculty. So everything is cut to fit the interest of everybody around. And next week program we will be monitoring and we will be showing to you soon is going to be live from New Delhi. It's mostly on neurosciences, neuroanesthesia and allied areas. And more than that, I like to make some announcements. Well, we are introducing something called the ICA PG assembly in line with the NYPGA, that is New York PG assembly, because New York PG assembly is something like 37 years old for the postgraduate students. The New York Society of Anesthesiologists has started an assembly, which is very popular in states as well as all over the world. It is one of the money worth program, I may say. In fact, we may go in along their line and we also make it more academic and rather good for the persons who are attending. And we may do it something like once a month, a PG assembly will be done. And well, all those details we will work out. And so please be on the lookout for that particular day when the PG assembly opens. Well, we'll have a trailer.
Siddharth, ek meeting mein hu, ek ghante mein baat karti hu.
We'll have a trailer in that. That means on 18th, we will show you something very near to that, because we're going to make a debate session on the postgraduate students with their mentoring faculty member. That means two different groups picked up from two different medical postgraduate institutions in India will be brought over along with our webinar, and they will be given 15 plus 15, 20 minutes time to argue on a particular point. This is just to bring up their skills of argument and to make them absolutely all right in talking about anesthesia, and which will be moderated by their own faculty members. And of course, there will be a neutral group of judges who will say what's going on. And last week, during our webinar, I put it as our peri-webinar quiz, because while the webinar was going on last week, we are putting up some questions across to all the audience as the students. And those who are able to come out with the answer in the shortest period of time, that means the fastest answering correct question was given a prize. Prize is certificate, and that's a certificate that was given to already, which is displayed. And for all purposes, we may have these certificates printed and given to you when you want it. Now, owing to the lockdown at certain areas in the country, printing is not very easily possible, but we can always convey the idea. We may be able to give e-certificate now, and probably it will be followed by a printed document also. Next. Well, we are starting our ultrasound training program. Ultrasound training program, which was rather suspended for some time, since it was not possible to be done at Delhi owing to some logistic problems. It is going to be restarted soon. The venue is going to be Rohtak, and the details of that I may be writing to everyone. Probably you may be getting that letter from me within a week's time with all its contents, and you could give advertisement of that particular program to all the students. This particular fellowship of 1.5 years duration we'll end up with awarding a fellowship by name IDRA. And another one, at Narayan Hridayalaya, Bangalore, the institution is starting, our ICA is starting a combined course, a hybrid course on the ultrasound as well as on the echocardiography. That means ultrasound as well as echocardiography combined together. We'll be putting it up, and within a month's time, the preliminary information will be put for everybody's convenience. This will be a certificate course of 1 year duration, whereas the other course is our classical IDRA course of 18 months duration, because all our fellowship programs are of 18 months. And again, any institution who wants to run a certificate course, well, they can do it, and we will give all support to them, but they should have the faculty consent to do the echo training as well as ultrasound training. Any institution who have the basic facility, they can start this particular program. And with this, I welcome you all to the webinar of the evening. And the webinar of the evening comes from Bangalore, and Dr. Muralidhar Kanchi is the moderator as well as the coordinator. I request Dr. Muralidhar Kanchi, who is our dean, to start the webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Radhakrishnan, for the introduction. I am indeed grateful to the ICA for the conducting these webinars, which have become very popular in the last 1 year. And today we are going to discuss about the first module of the cardiovascular monitoring. We'll be having four modules. The first module is today. And we'll be dealing with ECG and the blood pressure monitoring. And for this, we have three eminent panelists come moderators. I would like to invite Dr. Manjula Sarkar, Dr. Kodandaram, and Dr. Chaitali Sen for this meeting, August meeting in the August. So the Dr. Manjula Sarkar, most of you know her, but for the formality's sake, I will introduce her as the professor and in charge of Department of Cardiovascular and Thoracic Anesthesia in the prestigious D.Y. Patil Medical College, Navi Mumbai. She's a well-known teacher in cardiac anesthesia, and she has authored books, and she's in editorial board for several journals, and she has published about 100 papers in national and international journals. The second panelist or co-moderator is Dr. Kodandaram. He's a senior professor in the Department of Anesthesia in Akash Medical College, Bangalore. Again, a prolific teacher and trainer. He has trained several youngsters into the field of cardiac anesthesiology. The third panelist co-moderator is Dr. Chaitali Sengupta, who is the professor at the Postgraduate Institute of Medical Research in Medical Education and Research in Kolkata. And she has held several important positions, including Scientific Secretary, Executive Council Member of IACTA, and Scientific Secretary for ISCA West Bengal. And she is a very popular faculty member in all these things. With this, I would hand over the mic to Dr. Manjula Sarkar to request her to initiate the proceedings by calling the speakers. And the speaker time is 24 to 25 minutes, at the end of which there will be a bell rung. And I request all the participants except the panelists and the speaker to mute their mics and keep the videos off till the question hour. The three talks will be followed by question answer session. You may either put your questions on the chat box, or you may unmute yourself during the question answer session and address the question to the faculty. With that few words, I request Dr. Manjula Sarkar to take over the podium. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for a kind introduction. And as you always praise me for, I don't know whether I deserve that praising or not, but your praising is always there. And it really inspiring me to do many things. Thanks once again for that. So we are starting the session, and today's first speaker is Dr. Guru Dutt. And Dr. Guru Dutt can share his screen. And he is also the well-known cardiac anesthesiologist. His major achievements are Neon Excellence Award for Educational Initiatives. He is the Director General of Anesthesia. He served in Army Medical Corporation as a captain for 5 years, and he was professor in head in the Department of Anesthesia, Mysore Medical College. He has many national and international publications in his credit, and he has presented many guest lectures in the conferences. So I welcome you, sir, to give us the talk on ECG monitoring. ECG monitoring is very important for all of us, whether we are doing the cardiac anesthesia or non-cardiac anesthesia. So we know the importance of ECG, and I think it is going to be a good topic for every one of us. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, madam. And good evening, everybody. And thanks, ICA and Dr. Muralidhar for this opportunity. And also, I would like to bring greetings from my medical college, JSS Medical College and Hospital, to everybody. So you know that ECG monitoring is one of the oldest modalities probably, and you know it's one of the most common modalities of hemodynamic monitoring that all over the world we use. And many of the abnormalities in the rate or in the rhythm or even the myocardial ischemia can be identified early and can be managed with this ECG monitoring. So today I'll be discussing in brief about the basics of ECG monitoring and also the most common abnormal rhythms what we get during our perioperative period, and also regarding how to identify the myocardial ischemia. So we know that you know SCN node is the most dominant pacemaker in the heart, and it is situated at the junction of superior vena cava and then the right atrium. So it is the one SCN node is the one which actually initiates the impulse or generates the impulse. Once the impulse is generated by the SCN node, now the impulse quickly starts moving towards both the atria. Both the atria will get depolarized. In the meantime, the impulse also will go to the AV node. So here there is a deliberate delay that nature has made. This delay is mainly in order to see that there can be a sequential depolarization of the atria and ventricles. That means when the atria are depolarizing, the ventricles should be relaxing. So that is done by this AV node, which delays the conduction of this impulse. And after that, the impulse will go to the bundle of his, and then the right bundle, and then the left bundle, and then you know the whole of the left ventricle will get depolarized. This electrical activity of the heart was first you know graphically displayed by Anthovan in the year 1895, and actually he got the you know Nobel Award also in 1924. He introduced this bipolar limb leads. So his leads were, you know, lead one, lead two, and lead three. Later, Goldberger introduced the augmented unipolar limb leads. So much later, actually, the chest leads were introduced by Wilson. So these leads, these spell leads, are usually the routine leads that we usually use for recording an ECG on a paper. But there, what we will be doing is the limb the lead electrodes. They are usually placed in the peripheries of the limbs, either over the wrist joints or and also over the ankle joints. But when we use, we cannot you know keep these electrodes like that when we want to actually monitor the patient perioperatively. So usually, what we follow is the positions that are you know introduced by Mason. Like here, I would like to tell you a few things about the particularly where to keep these electrodes. Now, the limb electrodes should always be placed over the bony points. Why they should be placed over bony points is that if they are not placed over the bony points, if they are placed otherwise over the soft tissues, any movement of the soft tissues, especially during respiration, during inspiration and expiration, there can be, you know, changing in the baseline of the ECG. Hence, they have to be placed over the bony prominences, especially you know, over the lateral end of the clavicle or over the pelvic bones. So the other very important thing is, before placing the electrode, you'll have to reduce the skin impedance. So how to reduce the skin impedance is, you know, by rubbing the skin there. You can see in this video, I'm rubbing the skin so that you produce some amount of erythema. So by rubbing the skin, you are going to reduce the thickness of the stratum corneum. So once the stratum corneum thickness is reduced, the resistance offered by the skin is reduced by a factor of nearly 10 to 100. So the next thing is, you will have to fix these and also cover these electrodes by waterproof tapes. It is always better. So what is the idea behind this is, you know, many times you also must have felt that suddenly the ECG electrode will come out. Though the gum is there, it may not be properly sticking. The second problem is, you know, the surgeons will be using the antiseptic solutions that also can percolate and then can dislodge the ECG electrode. So this is very important. So we have to follow this. Next, coming to the number of electrodes we should use. You know, if you are using only 3 electrodes, then the number of leads you can monitor is only 1. Only the bipolar limb leads you can monitor, either lead 1, lead 2, or lead 3. So if you add one more lead, if you are monitoring with 4 electrodes, you can actually monitor 6 leads. That is both the limb leads, that's the bipolar and unipolar limb leads. If you add a chest lead or chest electrode also, you can even monitor a chest lead also. So now most of the time we'll be monitoring using the 5 electrodes. So when we are using 5 electrodes, the most often, so the leads what we will be using is either lead 2, both the lead 2 and V5. You know, lead 2 is always, we use it for rhythm disturbances, because lead 2 is from right arm to the left leg. So it is in the same axis as the heart. Because it is in the same axis of the heart, all the waves, the PQRST are very well seen, especially the P wave is very important to identify any abnormality. So that is the reason we use lead 2 for any abnormal rhythm. And V5, usually, because it represents the left ventricle, any myocardial ischemia of the left ventricle is very, very important to detect for us. So that is the reason why majority of the times we'll be monitoring the lead 2 and V5. So in an ECG, when we are recording on a paper, usually the speed with which what we use is 25 millimeter per second. The same speed also is used for recording the ECG and monitoring the ECG on a monitor as well. So in an ECG paper, usually we require to know about this speed to know exactly to calculate the rate so that the RR interval, the small squares, we just know, and then 1,500 divided by this number of small squares, we get the rate, or 300 divided by the large squares. But when we are monitoring the ECG on a monitor, we need not have to do that because, you know, the rate is always displayed. Now coming to the complexes, what we have to study is, you know, the PQRST and also the intervals also we are supposed to know about. We have the PR interval, we have the QRS width also, and we have the QT interval also. Here, you know, the P wave represents the atrial depolarization. So any abnormality of the P wave, we know that there is some problem in the atrial depolarization. Especially, for example, if the origin of the impulse is somewhere other than the SNR, like an atrial ectopic, then the P wave will be abnormal. And also it is very important to see that whether the P wave is present or absent, because many of the abnormal rhythms we can identify by seeing whether the P wave is present or not. And also we can easily identify if there is abnormality of the P wave by, you know, if there is any right atrial enlargement or the left atrial enlargement, we know the P pulmonal or P mitral, we can easily diagnose. The other thing is the PR interval, the normal PR interval, you know, it is 0.12 to 0.2 seconds. And any prolongation of the PR interval, we always say that it's a first degree AV block. It can occur even intraoperatively also. It can be due to many other causes can be, majority of the times can be drugs like digoxin can produce, even hyperkalemia can produce. There can be a shortening of the PR interval also in some of the patients, like patients with pre-excitation syndrome like Wolff Hoerkens and White syndrome or even LGL syndrome. And coming to the QRS complex, so width of the QRS is also very important. So usually the QRS is narrow, so it can be wide in patients with von Braun block like RBBB or LBBB. And next is coming to the the ST segment as such. So ST segment monitoring is also very important. So we can easily know whether there is any ischemia intraoperatively or not. And then the QT interval, of course, QT interval is very important. You know, preoperative time only, we have to look for any prolongation of the PR QT interval is there or not. Because, you know, if in these patients, they are highly prone to develop a multifocal ventricular tachycardia or polymorphic ventricular tachycardia like Tarsity's pointis as well. Now coming to the common ECG abnormalities, they're usually classified, as you all know, as tachyarrhythmias and bradyarrhythmias. And also there can be abnormalities regarding the myocardial ischemia can be there, and also there can be electrolyte imbalances also can be there. One of the common arrhythmias what we see is the sinus arrhythmia. Sinus arrhythmia is, it's nothing but variation of the heart rate in response to the respiration. So usually in these patients with sinus arrhythmia, there can be increase in the heart rate during inspiration and also decrease in the heart rate during expiration. So it's very common in children where there is vagal dominance, and it is very important to identify this kind of arrhythmia also, especially in young adults when they are posted for surgery and we are planning for spinal anesthesia, because many times when we give a spinal anesthesia and produce a sympathetic block, suddenly the increase in the parasympathetic dominance can produce severe bradycardia and also can produce an arrest. So that's why this sinus arrhythmia is again important for us as anesthesiologists. So most common causes for intra-op dysrhythmias, you all know that lidocaine subanesthesia, always I keep telling to the students also, if there is any abnormal rhythm intraoperatively, any dysrhythmias that occur, you just tell that it is, the cause is due to lidocaines, you are always correct. And also it is very important for us to know that because this is the most common cause, it is very important to keep the patient in deeper plane of anesthesia all the time. So other causes can be hypoxia, hypercarbia, hypocarbia, and pre-existing cardiac diseases, endocrine diseases, electrolyte disturbances, and also acid-base disturbances can also produce the dysrhythmias, and many times the drugs are also common causes for producing intra-op dysrhythmias. Coming to the most common dysrhythmias intraoperatively we come across, sinus tachycardia is most common tachycardia, most common dysrhythmia we come across. Usually the rate is increased. Other than that, all the relationship between the PE wave, QRS complex, STT wave, everything will be normal. So here the rate can be above 100 and it can go up to 150. And majority of the times the causes we already discussed, those can be the common causes. So most of the time you just treat the cause, the patients will be all right. But in certain situations or certain cardiac conditions, this can be quite dangerous, especially in patients with already having an ischemic heart disease, patients with stenosed valves like mitral stenosis or aortic stenosis, or the patient is having obstructive cardiomyopathy. In these patients, they require the normal sinus rate of between 60 to 80. Any increase in rate can produce serious problems in these patients. So in such situations, this sinus tachycardia requires treatment by beta blockers. Then the other tachycardia we can come across is the SVT, supraventricular tachycardias. Here, the rate is more than the sinus tachycardia. It will be much higher. It can be as high as 150 to 250 beats per minute. The QRS complexes, majority of the times they'll be narrow unless the patient is already having a, von Braun block, then there will be quite a bit of difficulty in diagnosing or whether it is a supraventricular tachycardia or a monomorphic ventricular tachycardia. So P wave you'll not be able to differentiate the P wave because it may get merged with the QRS complex. if a patient develops an SVT and if he is hemodynamically stable, so then you know, we can definitely try vagal maneuvers like carotid sinus massage, or you know, the drug of choice would be adenosine. If the patient is hemodynamically unstable, better to go for cardioversion. So the other dysrhythmia you can also come across is the atrial flutter. So here, you know, rate is around 150 to 200. That is the ventricular rate. The atrial rate may be much higher, 200 to 300. But you know, the P waves would be absent. The P waves are replaced by the flutter waves. So majority of the times in the atrial flutter, the QRS complexes will be regular. So anytime this atrial flutter can change to atrial fibrillation, which is slightly more dangerous rhythm than the atrial flutter itself. So atrial fibrillation can be easily diagnosed by, you know, absent P waves replaced by flutter waves with irregularly placed narrow QRS complexes. So that's how you can easily, you know, identify an atrial fibrillation. The rate also can be about 150 to 250. The most common causes of intraoperative atrial fibrillation can be, you know, patient already having mitral stenosis, hyperthyroidism, hypertension, especially geriatric patients, or even patients having collagen disorders. So especially in these patients with mitral stenosis or even geriatric patients, if suddenly if this occurs, so the patients can immediately go for pulmonary edema. So that is the reason, if there is atrial fibrillation developing intraoperatively, you'll have to look for the cardiovascular stability. If the patient is hemodynamically stable, then one can go for rate control or the rhythm control. Rate control is usually achieved by using beta blockers or even calcium channel blockers. So pharmacologically, you can achieve rhythm control by using amiodarone. But if the patient is hemodynamically unstable, it is always better to go for cardioversion using, you know, 100 joules of biphasic defibrillator. So coming to the premature atrial contractions. So here, you know, the origin of this premature atrial contraction is from a focus other than the SA node. So because it is arising from a focus other than the SA node, so the P wave will be abnormal here, and it will be premature in origin also. The other thing is, when it occurs, usually because it is from a focus in the atria, so it also resets the SA node. So because of this, invariably the next P wave will come with the regular PP interval, and there won't be any compensatory pause. Coming to the ventricular premature contractions. Now, atrial premature contractions are usually benign and may not require any treatment intraoperatively, but ventricular premature contractions may be pathological and may require treatment intraoperatively. So how do we recognize the premature ventricular contractions is, you know, there will be an absent P wave and a wide bizarre QRS complex with usually the T wave will be opposite the QRS complex. So whenever it occurs, so we should also know when the, you know, these premature ventricular contractions should be treated. So one thing is, if they are in multiple in number, so the suppose if they are more than 6 in number per minute, then they require treatment. When they are multifocal in origin, that means, you know, if you are recording a single rhythm of these, you know, the ECG, and the morphology of each one of these VPCs are different in the same rhythm, then we can say it is multifocal in origin. And also, if there is trigeminy or bigeminy, bigeminy is a normal beat, and the second every second beat is an ventricular ectopic. Trigeminy is, you know, after two normal beats, the third beat will be a ventricular ectopic. The next thing, you know, that if there is an R on T phenomenon, because if the R wave of the ventricular premature contraction falls on the T wave, because the T wave represents the repolarization phase, and if this R falls on this T wave of the previous beat, then there is a chance that the patient may go in for ventricular fibrillation. So that is also, you require this kind of VPCs you have to treat. And, you know, finally, if there are runs of ventricular ectopics, like three or four, almost mimicking ventricular tachycardia, then these, you know, ventricular premature contractions require treatment. And, you know, the drug of choice is lidocaine. You can give a bolus and then follow it up with the infusion. Coming to the other tachycardia, the monomorphic ventricular tachycardia. So here, you know, you can identify easily this. It's a broad complex tachycardia, and the complexes are similar in morphology, and each complex is wide and bizarre, and majority of the times the rhythm will be regular. So if this occurs intraoperatively, the patient is hemodynamically stable, then we can use amiodarone as the drug of choice. And if the patient is unstable, better to cardiovert the patient. So the other tachycardia is polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. Sometimes it can be torsades de pointis also. So here, you know, the each of these QRS complexes will be of different morphology. If there is a torsades de pointis also, it appears like twisting around a central axis. So majority of the times the patients may be unstable, but if they are stable, then it can be due to a prolonged QT interval, and one can treat with magnesium. If the patient is unstable, it is better to go for electrical defibrillation. So the next, you know, the other abnormal waveform can be ventricular fibrillation. Here, the absent rate and rhythm also will not be there. Or, you know, you can have a bizarre waveform, and invariably the patient will be in cardiac arrest, and you know, the management is by CPR and defibrillation. Coming to the bradyarrhythmias, so one of the most common bradyarrhythmias is sinus bradycardia. Here only the rate is decreased to less than 60, and in patients with who are on beta blockers or calcium channel blockers, we consider sinus bradycardia when the rate comes down to less than 55. And they are also one of the most common causes of the sinus bradycardia intraoperatively. So the other drugs also can produce, like, you know, succinylcholine, especially the second dose of succinylcholine is notorious to produce this sinus bradycardia. And some of the reflexes like ocular cardiac reflex, especially in pediatric age group, and the peritoneal traction, especially it's very common nowadays with the laparoscopic surgeries, you know, sudden peritoneal insufflation with carbon dioxide. So the vagal reflex occur, and you know, the immediately the patient can go in for bradycardia, and sometimes the, you know, arrest also can occur. So immediately you have to treat this kind of bradycardia if the patient also has any unstable cardiovascular system, like, you know, you may be having all signs and symptoms of decreased cardiac output. Better to treat using atropine. Coming to the AV blocks, you know, first degree AV block, there is only a prolongation of the PR interval. So many times this does not require any treatment. Most of these patients will be asymptomatic, but definitely anytime this can go for second degree AV block. So second degree AV block, we have two types, Mobitz type 1 and type 2. In Mobitz type 1, also called as Benkebach phenomenon, wherein a gradual prolongation of the PR interval will be there, and suddenly there will be an absent QRS complex. So the Mobitz type 2 is, you know, their PR interval will be normal only, but regularly or irregularly, there will be a missing of the QRS complex. So of these second degree AV blocks, Mobitz type 2 is more probably significant, more dangerous also, because many times it can produce symptoms, or many times it can, even intraoperatively, it can go to a complete heart block also. So complete heart block, you know, here there is a total block for the impulse to go across from the SA node to the AV node. So here the P waves will be coming by themselves, the QRS complexes are also coming by themselves, there will be absolute no relationship between the P waves and then the QRS complexes. And if it is an acquired complete heart block, invariably the ventricular rate can be very low. It can be as low as less than 45 beats per minute. So invariably many of these patients will have all symptoms of and signs of decreased cardiac output, and they usually require a permanent pacemaker. So if we find this in the preoperative period, so we may require to ask for a permanent pacemaker to be placed. But if this occurs intraoperatively, it is always, you know, you have to use a temporary pacemaker for pacing the heart. So many of these patients with sinus node problems or even AV nodal problems can also come with a pacemaker already there. So that we have to know about these captured beats. And captured beats you can easily identify by looking at these spikes. So suppose the spike is before a P wave, you know that the pacemaker is an atrial pacemaker. And if it is before a QRS complex, it can be a ventricular pacemaker. And if it is coming both before P wave and the QRS complex, it can be a sequential pacemaker facing both the atria and ventricles. So Bund-Braun blocks, you know, the QRS complexes will be wide, and just see the QRS complex in the V1 and V2. If there are positive R waves are there in V1 and V2, it is RBBB. And if it is a QRS complex is there, a small R is there in the V1 and V2, it is definitely a left Bund-Braun block, which is more pathological because RBBB can be a normal variant also. Coming to the identification of the myocardial ischemias, you should always look for the J point. So the J point is, you know, the junction between the S wave and the ST segment. And usually the measuring point is about 2 millimeters away from the J point. So it's about 80 milliseconds. So we will have to look for from the isoelectric line, how much of, depression or elevation of this J point has, this ST complex has occurred. So there can be both depression and elevation. So if there is a subendocardial injury, there can be only an ST depression can be there. If it is through and through transmural injury is there, there can be an ST elevation. So when we are recording the, when we are monitoring the patient, so it all depends on which coronary artery is involved also. We can identify by looking at the leads in which we are finding these kind of changes. Suppose if the change is there in lead 2-3 AVF, so it can be an inferior wall where right coronary artery is involved. It can be anteroseptal, wherein the left anterior descending artery is involved. So then you can easily find out in V1 and V2 these changes. If it is anterior, you can find out in the V3, V4, the left anterior descending is the one which is involved. And if it is the lateral, the anterolateral, then even LAD and circumflex may be involved. And you can find these changes in lead 1, ABL, and V5 and V6. So regarding the sensitivity is again important for us to know. If we are using only one lead V5 for recognizing the myocardial ischemia, so sensitivity is just 69%. We are using the lead 2 and V5. Lead 2 represents the inferior wall, the right coronary. Then our sensitivity can be higher. So if you are using lead 2, V4 and V5, the sensitivity can be as high as 96%. So there are still a lot of abnormalities we can detect, especially the electrolyte imbalances also. But lack of time, I'll not be able to discuss everything. So just to summarize, it's very important to place these electrodes properly and also to identify the abnormal rhythm as early as possible. And also if there is a myocardial ischemia in the postoperative period or in the intraoperative period, so that immediately you can manage these kind of problems and you can be a very safe anesthesia. Thank you. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Gurudat, for excellent and elaborative talk on ECG basics and its importance in anesthesia and how to diagnose and take the advantage of ECG monitoring. Now, our second speaker is Dr. Radhika, and she's going to speak on non-invasive blood pressure monitoring. Dr. Radhika.
Good evening. Dr. Kodandram here. Am I audible?
Yes, hello. Dr. Kodandram, we can hear you.
Supposed to introduce Dr. Radhika to the audience. Actually, Dr. Radhika doesn't need much of introduction. She is a very popular professor among all the students in various colleges, like she has worked in MS Ramaiah Medical College, St. John's Medical College, and now she is the professor and head of the department in Vaidehi Medical College. So she has served in academic circles for all these years and trained number of students. She has also occupied various posts from secretary level to president post in the Bangalore City chapter of Indian Society of Anesthesiologists. And she has also participated in various CME programs, workshops, and has given lectures at various levels from city, state, and national levels. And it is our fortune that she is now speaking on a very important topic, that is the non-invasive monitoring in blood pressure. I invite her to take this slot and address the audience regarding the same. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Kodandram. Without any delay, we will proceed with the next vital cardiovascular monitoring, which is the non-invasive blood pressure. So after Dr. Gurudat spoke about the ECG, this is the second monitor, which is the minimum mandatory monitoring required by almost all anesthesia associations around the world. So man, being the curious animal that he is, has since the last 170 years tried to find out what drives the blood in the vessels, how the heart pumps, and what is happening in the various blood vessels of the body. So it started in about 1854 and started with a sphygmomanograph. Then you had a sphygmomanometer, and then Harvey Cushing introduced monitoring during anesthesia, and some von Recklinghausen, he made a wider cuff. And with all this, people tried to monitor this vital sign. So it's important because with only this single monitor, 93% of adverse cardiovascular events can be detected in the perioperative period. Before we start our talk over the next 20 odd minutes, I'd like to familiarize you with the common terms we'll use throughout this lecture, which is the blood pressure, lateral pressure exerted by the column of blood against the arterial wall, the systolic pressure, which is the highest pressure attained during the cardiac cycle, diastolic pressure, which is the lowest pressure attained during the cardiac cycle, the pulse pressure, which is the diastolic pressure plus one-third the systolic pressure, and last but most important, the mean arterial pressure, which is the diastolic plus the one-third of the pulse pressure. Now, I want to tell you, because we will be concentrating on the non-invasive monitoring, how it is not the systolic pressure, but it is the mean arterial pressure, which is a better indicator of perfusion of the organs of the body. So why do we have to know how to measure blood pressure? Because we also see patients in the OPD, so we need to know how to check the vital signs. Then in the OR, we need it. Post-operative recovery area, we need it. Non-operating room anesthesia, and finally in the critical care unit. So it's important that we get it right. So these various methods, I think palpatory is not so important for us. Maybe medical student and nurses may need to know that. We need to know definitely the auscultatory method. The Doppler method, it is to be listed, but it's inconvenient because you need another person to hold the Doppler device in place, and you need one person to record. So it's neither convenient nor time effective. Fourth will be the oscillometric method, which is what mostly this lecture will concentrate on. And lastly, the two newer methods on which I'll just show you a couple of slides, of interference plethysmography and tonometry. So this is just to remind you all. So you heard that. You heard the tapping, then you heard the swishing, and then You heard the knocking, and finally, so all of us who do the auscultatory method need to know these five phases. Here I want to highlight one point which may not be very familiar to all of you, that if the difference between muffling and silence is 10 millimeters, then the higher number has to be considered as the diastolic pressure. Important things like what should be the position of the limb when you record the non-invasive blood pressure. As you can see, this diagram is self-explanatory. So you have the cuff above the level of the heart. Then B, you have the cuff at the level of the heart. And C, you have the cuff below the level of the heart. So as you can see, the difference is usually about 5 to 6 millimeters of mercury. So they recommend that as far as possible, we do keep it at the level of the heart. Then have you tied it correctly? So you should not tie it over somebody's sleeve, and you should position the lower border about an inch above the antecubital fossa, and you should put the bladder centrally over the brachial artery. This shows a table where you have to use the correct size cuff. I think most of us know when we try to use the average adult cuff on an obese person and what the values we get. So by this table, we know what are the sizes of cuff to be used for different age groups. When should you not place a cuff on the arm? That if the hand is burned, if there's been a surgery on that limb, infection, cellulitis of that limb, the same side as the mastectomy, lymphedema due to any cause, maybe mastectomy or otherwise, the arm which has a AV fistula, any paretic or paralytic limb, and fracture of that limb. So what do we do when we cannot place it on that arm? So I'll show you a couple of slides about what we could do when we cannot place it on the upper arm. So now to concentrate on the oscillometric method. So as you can see, when the cuff is fully inflated, then the artery is completely collapsed and no blood flow happens through it. As the cuff is deflated below the systolic pressure, then the artery allows blood to flow through, and hence a vibratory motion is set up in the vessel wall. Now in the last diagram, the artery is fully open, the blood is flowing through it, and this is cross the diastolic pressure, and there is no vibration transmitted to the wall, and the pressure recording will stop here. So this shows you with simultaneously a Doppler held over the forearm. So this is the cuff which is inflating and then it deflates. So during that time, there will be complete stoppage of blood flow. And as it starts deflating, once again, the flow will commence and the vibrations will begin till the cuff is empty. So this is will show you what you normally do every day. This is the cuff gets inflated, the signals are amplified, pass through a filter, and they go to this black box. Okay. So now there's an algorithm here which translates these oscillations into these digits. Now this algorithm varies from brand to brand. So use Criticon or use Dynamap, whichever you use. This is a trade secret of the company, how they derive it. But finally, what you're interested in is, it displays the systolic, the diastolic, the mean, and also the heart rate, which is the greatest advantage of this method. So this once again shows you a lot of stress is placed on this oscillometric waveform. Okay? So we have the cuff inflating, the maximum oscillations will signal the mean arterial pressure, then the oscillations will decrease, then the diastole is over and normal blood flow is established. So this is called the oscillometric waveform envelope. And based on this, the algorithm is detected. Some more details about the cuff, which should cover at least 2/3 of the limb, and the width should be 40% of the mid circumference of the limb, and the middle of cuff should be placed over the brachial artery. Well, is it always accurate? No. If you have used an improper sized cuff, extremes of blood pressure, especially low blood pressure below 75 mm systolic, any arrhythmias, external pressure as the surgeon leaning over it, cuff inflation, hypertension, white coat hypertension, and if the patient is shivering. So all this will give erroneous values. But what are its advantages? What we discussed were very small disadvantages, which do not happen throughout the recording. See, when an individual checks it by auscultation, there are something called digit preference. Some people will just write to the nearest 0, 80. Another person will just write to the nearest 5, 85. So this is called digit preference. So these things do not happen with the NIBP. So the lack of observer variation, it's quite accurate. And you can set the cycle time. You can set it every 2 minutes or every half an hour. And more important, it will also display the pulse rate in case your ECG electrodes get wet or dislodged by the blood. And it's reproducible. You, as soon as one value comes, you press the button and once again, you'll get the another value. And it doesn't need much maintenance. It doesn't need to be recalibrated often. And definitely, it doesn't have the white coat effect. Now, I want to show you this study of about 80 odd patients where they tied non-invasive BP cuff on, say, the upper arm, and one more non-invasive on the left wrist, or they had one BP cuff, say, on left upper arm, and they might have had a right radial. So they compared two non-invasive BPs on two hands, or one non-invasive and the invasive. When they found that there is so much difference between the values you got in right arm, left arm, right wrist, left wrist. So they concluded that whatever value you record, it is for that limb only. You cannot say that in all the both the limbs and in the different location of the limb that you'll get a similar value. And right at the beginning, I would like to tell you that most of these non-cardiac surgery NIBP studies have been done in neurocritical care units, because they have this continuous recording of non-invasive BP, and they also have many patients who have invasive arterial lines. Now, when you have an obese patient, what do? You don't have an extra large cuff, so you can use it on the wrist, which I have done on many occasions. So use the same cuff on the wrist, and you will find that it's fairly accurate. And the we have compared it in the intra-arterial and non-invasive on the obese upper arm on the other side, and found a difference of about 6 mm in the systolic and less than that, maybe 3 mm in the MAP. Now, suppose a patient doesn't have a limb or both upper limbs are burnt, you can definitely tie it either on the calf or the ankle. So this is ankle, you can tie it higher on the calf. And what did they find? That the calf BP is more than the upper arm BP by 4 mm, and the ankle BP is more than the upper arm BP by about 8 mm. So as you can see, these will never be statistically significant. So for you to have a trend, I think it will be fairly useful for you to tie it wherever there is a arterial pulse. Now, what is the future? So we have what is known as a volume clamp method. So as you can see here, it's a small cuff put on a finger and there's an inflatable bladder. So the bladder gets inflated and compresses the vessels. So the principle is very similar to what is happening in your brachial artery. And infrared photoplethysmography will interpret these numbers. So you have the light source, the light detector, and you have the bladder, which will prevent any detection if it's inflated. So these are some various brands using this concept, ClearSight and CNAP. And well, whatever articles I read, they were not, they've not recommended it for use as yet, but they have found fairly good correlative values. Then this is the other one called the T-line. So here you have a transducer which is placed just over the skin, over the wrist, over the artery, over the radial artery. And but on the other, you have to have on the other side a bone. So you have to have an artery and beneath that there should be a bone. And then this transducer will transmit these vibrations of the artery and convert it into digits to be displayed on the monitor. So now there are many more, but these are the two promising ones. And what is expected of anything in the future? It should be non-invasive, right? We all trust invasive BP, but yes, we cannot do it all the time because one may be the skill, the cost, you know, maybe availability of the monitor in that OT may not have ability to connect to an invasive line, then it should be easy to use. So as I showed you the T-line, anybody can apply it to the wrist. And if it gives fairly accurate values, there's no need for you to cannulate the radial artery with all its attendant complications. Then it should be wireless and it should definitely be smart for the next generation to accept it. So now we look at some, what is the importance? Now we have discussed how to monitor BP correctly and we get some values. So what is the importance of these values that we see? So now this is some guidelines they put out and in which they've shown that the MAP should not be less than 60 to 70 mm for prolonged periods of time. If that happens, then it's associated with end organ injury, like to the brain, to the heart, and to the kidney. So this consensus statement came out and it showed that when the intraop BP is less than 60 to 70 millimeters, the systolic is more than 160, then the risk of myocardial injury, acute kidney injury, and death definitely increases. Now we have these two articles in which they've compared non-invasive blood pressure to intra-arterial. And definitely these articles show that they underestimate the non-invasive blood pressure, underestimates systolic readings, and overestimates diastolic readings, even at normal pressures. So when the pressures are at the extremes, definitely these differences will be much more. Kindly mute your mics.
Mute zalana.
All the participants excepting the speaker must keep the mics muted.
So now that we have shown you the importance of the non-invasive blood pressure, and towards the end, I showed you the differences between the invasive and the non-invasive. So I think it's right on my part to hand over the mic to Dr. Muralidhar so that he can tell you how they are different and how important invasive blood pressure monitoring is. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Radhika. It was a very comprehensive presentation on non-invasive blood pressure. We have covered all the points which are connected with the indirect pressure monitoring and also the commonly asked questions in the examination for the students. Now, we will take the questions at the end. I call upon Dr. Muralidhar to take up the next lecture. For this, I will request Dr. Chaitali Singh to introduce Dr. Muralidhar. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Radhika,
kindly
hello.
Unshare the screen, please.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
You're audible, ma'am.
Dr. Muralidhar is professor of anesthesiology and medical care and in Narayana Health. Everybody knows him for years together. He is holding world-class tea workshop for years. He's one of the strongest pillar of academics of IACTA and ICA. I think it will take nearly 15 minutes or more to talk about him. So right now, without telling very much about him, I would like to rather request him to start his deliberation. Sir, please.
Yeah, I'm just about to share the screen. 1 second.
Yeah.
The cannulation sites, commonly used cannulation sites are the radial artery and the femoral artery. Very, very occasionally, we may be using superficial temporal, axillary artery, brachial artery, posterior tibial, or the dorsalis pedis. But these are very, very rare occasions. But in general, we use the radial artery and the femoral artery. Before doing the femoral, the radial artery cannulation, the collateral circulation to the arm is checked by asking the patient to tighten the fist and the radial artery and the ulnar artery on both sides of the arm are compressed as is shown in this picture, and the ulnar artery is released, and the time taken for the blanching to disappear on the palmar surface of the hand is noted, and if the blood flow does not return within 10 seconds, it indicates that the collateral circulation may be impaired in that particular patient, which may contraindicate the placement of a radial artery catheter. And the technique of radial artery catheterization is shown here. This is the direct cannulation technique. The local anesthetic is given in patients who are conscious. Skin nick is made. And then the cannula, which is over the needle, is passed into the artery at first using 45 degrees and then reducing the angle to about 30 degrees. And what is important is to remove the hub of, look at the chamber here, which shows the return of blood from the arterial system into the hub of the needle. And when you're using the femoral artery, the puncture site should be below the inguinal ligament to avoid retroperitoneal hematoma as a result of accidental puncture of the intra-abdominal portion of the arterial system. Here again, you look for the flashback of blood in the chamber on the needle, and once the blood flow is seen, this catheter can be easily glided over the needle into the arterial system and then connect to the pressure transducer. You may choose to use the Seldinger technique where you enter the arterial system using a needle, and once the blood flow is established, you pass in a guide wire and remove the needle. As is shown here, the needle will be removed after the guide wire is in situ, and then the actual arterial catheter is passed over the guide wire into the arterial system and then connect to the pressure transducer. Next technique is using ultrasound. With ultrasound, we can locate the radial artery either in the longitudinal axis or in the short axis. The short axis is being shown here. The local infiltration is being done here. And then the catheter is passed. It can be seen inside the artery. And then you either use a guide wire and introduce the actual catheter, or the same catheter can be used for measuring the arterial blood. Sine waves are produced as a result of arterial pressure generated in the arterial system, and a combination of the fundamental wave and two-thirds of the secondary waves give rise to the arterial tracing as is shown here. And the mean arterial pressure is the diastolic pressure plus one-third the pulse pressure. This is a very important component, especially when you are monitoring patients in the ICU and in the operating rooms. Systolic, the mean arterial pressure of 65 and above is the target for most of the patients. And the components of the arterial waveform can be divided into six portions. This is the systolic upstroke, this is the systolic peak, and this is systolic decline, the dicrotic notch, and diastolic runoff, and the diastolic pressure. What is important to note here is that the electrical events precede the mechanical events by about 120 milliseconds, because this is the time taken for the electrical impulse to spread from the endocardium to the epicardial layers and the heart to contract, generation of LV pressure above the aortic pressure, opening of the aortic valve, and transmission of spall to the peripheral tissues. So this takes about 120 milliseconds, and that's why there's a delay between the electrical activation to the generation of the mechanical systole. And what is the effect of position on the arterial blood pressure compared to non-invasive and direct arterial blood pressure? When you're using the direct arterial blood pressure, irrespective of the position of the arterial cannula, either in the upper arm or lower arm in a lateral position, the reading will be precise and fairly accurate, because the arterial transducer is positioned in such a manner at the level of the heart. It is level zero to the level of the heart, and hence the arterial pressure measured in the right upper limb or the left upper limb will be similar. But this is not the case in a patient who is in lateral position when you are monitoring the non-invasive blood pressure. When you are measuring non-invasive blood pressure, the upper arm blood pressure will be lower than what is shown in the lower arm because of the gravitational effects. The physical characteristics of pressure measurement system are depicted in this slide. These are three in number: the natural frequency, this is the frequency at which the system resonates and amplifies the signal, which is dependent upon the diameter of the tubing, the length of the tubing, the compliance of the tubing, and the density of the fluid contained in the system. So the greater the diameter, lesser the length, lesser the compliance of the tubing, and lesser the density of the fluid contained in the monitoring system, it is better for accurate representation of the arterial blood pressure. The second terminology which is used is the frequency response, which is the ratio of the measure to the input amplitude at a specific frequency. And ideally, the measured amplitude and the input amplitude must be same to get the accurate reflection of the arterial blood pressure, and the ratio is actually one. The damping coefficient is the rate of dissipation of energy of a pressure waveform, and it is determined by looking at the amplitude ratio, which I'll be showing in the next few slides. Then we need to know what is underdamped arterial pressure waveform, in which in underdamped arterial wave pressure waveform, the systolic overshoot is there, and the systolic pressure measured is higher than what it should normally be. And there are secondary waveforms as a result of unphysiological vibrations or reflections of the blood in the arterial system, which is being transmitted through the transducer. And here the difficulty is to make out where is the dicrotic notch. And this is an overdamped system. What we saw was the underdamped system where the systolic overshoot was there. This is underdamped system where there is systolic pressure is under it, but in most of the patients, the mean pressure will be reasonably accurate. How to measure the natural frequency and damping coefficient? We need to do a fast flush test by holding the tag on the transducer and pulling and leaving it suddenly, which produces secondary waveform. These are the oscillations produced once the tag is released, and the distance between the two successive oscillations determines the natural frequency, whereas the height of the two successive waveforms determines the damping coefficient. As we go from the center to the peripheral arteries, there is the amplification of the pulse wave as a result of reflection or resonance of the waveform from the peripheral vascular resistance. So as you go from the central artery to a farther peripheral artery, the pulse pressure is increased and the systolic upstroke is delayed as compared to the central. See here, the systolic stroke is occurring here, but here is delayed and the dicrotic notch is slurred. You cannot really know where is the dicrotic notch as you go to the peripheral artery. This is also depicted in this picture where there's delay in the systolic peak of the pulse pressure waveform as you move away from the center. As a person becomes elderly, there is reduction in the arterial compliance, and this causes early reflection of the pulse wave, producing increased pulse pressure, which is shown on the diagram on the right side of the screen as compared to the normal person's arterial pressure waveform. This depiction shows us the pathological conditions which influence the arterial waveform. The one which is shown on the left upper quadrant is the normal waveform, where there is almost coincident increase in the arterial pressure as compared to the pulmonary artery pressure. But in patients who have aortic stenosis, the arterial pressure is much delayed, producing pulses tardus and parvus. This is the pulmonary artery pressure tracing, and this is the arterial pressure tracing. So if you compare them, there's delay in the arterial pressure tracing going up. And in patients who have aortic regurgitation, there is bifid pulse. For each pulse, there are two components, and then hence it's called as pulses bisphorans. And in patients who have hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, what you see is a spike and dome pattern. Now coming to the pulses alternans and pulses bigeminae and the pulses paradoxes. These three terminologies we should know. Pulses alternans, the every second pulse is weak pulse, which is typically seen in patients who have left ventricular dysfunction. In comparison, if it's a pulses bigeminae, every pulse is weak. Every second pulse is weaker than the preceding pulse. But if you look at the ECG, every second beat will be ventricular ectopic. Whereas in pulses alternans, the ECG will show normal sinus rhythm. Then coming to pulses paradoxes, it's not really a paradox because this is an exaggeration of the normal physiological changes in the systolic blood pressure, which take place with inspiration and expiration. In a normal inspiration, there is a decline in the systolic blood pressure by about 6 to 10 millimeters of mercury normally as a result of changes in the intrathoracic pressure. But if this difference between the systolic and the systolic pressure during inspiration and expiration is greater than 10 millimeters of mercury, it is called as pulses paradoxes. And this is the pressure waveform in a patient who is on intra-aortic balloon pump. There are four cardiac cycles shown here. Every second heartbeat is being diastolic augmented using the intra-aortic balloon pump. This is the augmented pressure. This is the unassisted systolic pressure. This is the dicrotic notch. This is the augmented diastolic pressure. And this is the end diastolic pressure after the diastolic augmentation, which is lower than the unassisted systole. And this is the systolic pressure after the diastolic augmentation. If you notice, this point and this point, the after the diastolic augmentation, systolic pressure is low and diastolic pressure is low respectively, which means that the after load to the left ventricle is decreased. Now coming to the reverse pulses paradoxes, when we put the patients on ventilator, we are mechanically ventilated, who are paralyzed, and the tidal volume is at least 8 ml per kilogram of body weight, there is a difference in the systolic pressure during inspiration and expiration. The systolic pressure is increased during inspiration as compared to expiration, which is the reverse of normal respiration. And this difference, which is called a systolic pressure variation, if the pressure the difference is greater than 13%, it indicates volume responsiveness and patient may be hypovolemic. Same, using a similar principle, you also can look at the pulse pressure variation. The pulse pressure is greater during inspiratory cycle, phase of the respiratory cycle, as compared to the expiratory cycle, cycle of the respiration, when the patient's on mechanical ventilation, fully paralyzed, and when you're using at least 8 ml per kilogram of tidal ventilation. So this difference again can be used to derive the pulse pressure variation, and if it's more than 13%, it again indicates hypovolemic condition. The same measurements are shown here, and this depiction shows the typical, the famous Frank-Starling relationship. On the horizontal axis, we have the filling pressures or the preload. And on the vertical axis, we have the stroke volume or the cardiac index. And you have the two portions of the Frank-Starling curve. This is the ascending portion and this is the flat portion. In the ascending portion, as we give volume, there is increase in the stroke volume. If you increase the filling pressure, the stroke volume increases. And in the flat portion of the curve, with increase in the volume, the stroke volume increase is not that much. So this is depicted in the pulse pressure variation. The pulse pressure variation is greater here in the arterial tracing, whereas here there's no pulse pressure variation with the mechanical ventilation. So this can be utilized to dictate or determine the fluid status in a given particular patient. And now in the recent couple of years, there has been a lot of interest to predict that hypotension is going to occur in the next 10 minutes or 15 minutes by using what is called as hypotension prediction index, which has been determined by using the algorithms which are built up in this specific monitor. And this is called the hypotension prediction index, and it's a unitless number. And if it is greater than 85, it means that the patient is likely to develop hypotension within the next 10 to 20 minutes. And this gives us an opportunity to proactively act on this information and correct the abnormalities which the patient may be suffering. This is called as the hypotension prediction index. And in this, five parameters are used: the systolic period of the arterial tracing, the diastolic phase, and the systolic increase, systolic decline, and the diastolic decline in the blood pressure is taken. These five parameters are used to construct the hypotension prediction index, and this has been used successfully this has been suggested to be a parameter which can be used to predict the occurrence of hypotension in the next 10 to 15 minutes. And the other thing I would like to mention is that the mean arterial pressure, we say that 65 millimeters, the mean arterial pressure should be maintained. But in patients who are hypertensive and diabetic and other cardiovascular abnormalities, the autoregulatory limits are shifted to rightwards and upwards. And what is the mean arterial pressure? Okay, for a young patient, 65 millimeters may not be sufficient. For an elderly individual, so we say that one size does not fit all. And hence the treatment now is directed towards personalizing the personalized care of patients. And in conclusion, I would say that the presence of an anesthesiologist in an operating room is the most important monitor, which is essential component of patient safety. The anesthesiologist may use his eyes, hand, and ear to monitor the patient. And invasive arterial pressure monitoring is indicated in selected patients, such as those undergoing cardiac surgery, thoracic surgery, intracranial surgery, critically ill patients, high-risk patients, critically ill patients in intensive care units, etc. Accurate measurement and interpretation of the data is necessary for optimal patient care. And we should know the drawbacks and pitfalls in monitoring before we initiate the treatment based on the numbers produced by these monitors. Before I end, I would like to, I hope this video works. I would like to invite you for the IACRT workshop, which is slated on the 20th, 21st and 22nd of this month. Where this will be a virtual workshop. There are 100 eminent experts from across the globe who will be participating and imparting their knowledge. And don't miss the Golden Fate contest and research paper presentations. And please register so that you may get credit points if you register. With that, I would like I would like to thank you for being patient with me, and thank you very much. If there are any questions, I will be happy to answer them.
Thank you, sir, for your excellent deliberation in spite of these technical faults.
Yeah, I was really upset to myself. I don't know, everything it happens with me.
Can you please explain, sir, for the criteria for prediction of hypotension by hypotension prediction index again?
Very good. What they have done is they have taken as many as 20,000 hypotensive episodes which have occurred. And based on that, they have built up an algorithm taking the five parameters which I showed on the arterial tracing. How is the systolic upstroke? How is the decline of the systolic pressure, the diastolic pressure? And they have also looked at the systolic time period and diastolic time period. They have taken five parameters. And based on these parameters, they have built up an algorithm and they have proposed that hypotension is going to occur if this parameter, which is called as hypotension prediction index, is greater than 86. It is not percentage, it's just a number. It does not have any unit. So if it is greater than 86, they claim that, it is claimed that the patient is going to develop hypotension within the next 10 to 15 minutes. So the problem here is if the patient is going on bypass and if there are no pulsations, it will not work in that situation. And there are some situations, for example, patients having arrhythmias, atrial fibrillation, it may not really work in those situations. So, but this is being proposed and we need to see how it comes up in the near future, whether it will be really predictive of hypotension in hypotension, which can be useful in our day-to-day management of patients.
Okay, thank you, sir. Any other question for Dr. Mulley? Any other question is there?
I think half the people have disappeared by now.
No, sir, there are at least 50 people. Manjula, ma'am, you have any question to serve?
Any questions, comments are most welcome.
If no question is there, then I have
one comment I want to make. Just
yes, please feel free.
This is a cardiovascular monitoring, and we are module one, and we are talking about basic ECG and indirect blood pressure or direct blood pressure.
Yes.
The finger on the pulse still is very important, and that should be one of the primary monitors which we should not forget as a student on the practitioner.
Anesthesia.
Finger on the pulse is still very important.
So. Absolutely correct. That habit is not inculcated nowadays. And if I remember in PGI in the 80s when I did my MD, if you are not having a hand on the pulse, somebody will come and hit you from the backside.
And you will have some metacarpal fracture.
Yeah. I know this is very important, and especially I stress that point, especially if the patient is having pacemaker, because the ECG will be saying some pacemaker complexes and you think that the heart is working, but heart may not be working. You must have hand on the pulse or plethysmographic tracing of the pulse oximeter or the arterial pressure showing waveform. These are some of the methods to detect that the mechanical systoles are actually happening in a given patient.
One more thing I wanted to tell is about the students to know the difference between the pulse rate and the heart rate. In what conditions there is difference between pulse rate and heart rate?
Absolutely.
We ask in the exam. You must know where the pulse dip comes, what are the conditions, and why it happens.
Absolutely. Correct. You know that in patients who have cardiac arrhythmias, all the electrical activity of the heart may not be as forceful. I mean, all this contraction may not be as strong as the previous one. Some of the pulse may not be transmitted up to the peripheral artery. It may be missed when you are feeling the pulse. The heart rate and the pulse rate may be different in that situation. It's usually described as pulse deficit, especially seen in patients who have atrial fibrillation.
The other thing that's useful is the esophageal stethoscope.
Very good point. Yes.
Heart quality of the heart sounds, which is allows you to move around a little bit in case you can't palpate the pulse.
Absolutely true. I agree.
And one question to Dr. Gurudhar, if he is online.
Yes.
Dr. Gurudhar?
Yeah. Please ask.
Hello.
Nice to see you after a long, long time, Dr. Kodandram.
Yeah. Very, very pleasant to see you. Just I wanted you to tell something about the common artifacts that we come across on the EC, how to get rid of them, especially electromagnetic interventions and the how we can filter them out.
Yeah, usually, you know, majority of the times it is the diathermy. Invariably we will have, though there is a filter there for this diathermy, we activate this filter also. Even then, you cannot, even yesterday I was trying for this only, it was not possible. So that is one of the common problems we do come across. Yeah. Very difficult. Especially with diathermy and ECG.
Yeah. That's why they is always required to have simultaneously the other, like the seismography or the pressure tracing. So that will give us the idea how the CBS is performing.
Exactly.
So not dependent totally on the ECG.
Yeah, that is there, but these artifacts you cannot do away with on the ECG.
Especially diathermy is impossible to out completely.
I have one question to Dr. Radhika. Is she there? Dr. Radhika, are you there?
Dr. Radhika?
Yes.
Okay. I have one question. That is probably virtual pressure measurement is being used by the smartwatch. Smartwatches, which are coming to the market right now. So what is your opinion regarding that?
That is okay for ambulatory monitoring, which a physician, a cardiologist will need. Suppose they want to treat hypertension.
Smartwatch is actually being used by the lay people. They are using it and they are seeing that their pressure and their heart rate and everything they are seeing there.
That's so right. If the physician wants to monitor the blood pressure, they can do it with the smartwatch, which now measures the blood pressure, but it will not help us at all. This is an anesthesia lecture, I did not include because it's not at all useful in anesthesia practice.
No, it cannot be very accurate also, madam.
Yes. It was not meant for us. It was meant to be ambulatory, to be used by cardiologists and physicians. Mm.
And I have another question. That is, you got any study comparing arterial applanation, tonometer, and volume pump method? And what is the conclusion of those studies?
Ma'am, are you asking me?
Yeah, yeah.
Can you repeat it?
Any study comparing atrial apparition tonometry and volume clamp method? You got any study?
No, that many articles are not there. They've just given the technique of this volume clamp, but I really did not find any literature on that.
Is your opinion?
Appellation tonometry is yes. An non-invasive method of measuring blood pressure.
That is the T line.
That is continuous method. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. What they do is they place a transducer over the radial artery and
radial artery over the bone.
Sir, I showed that.
Yes.
He showed that. Yeah.
Yes.
How much reliable are they, sir? That is my question.
So now this. Plethysmography and all is just put on the web by Edwards. So I don't know. It's not put by any doctors who have conducted a study.
These are reliable.
Not many study has been done on this.
My impression is that these methods are reliable when the patient is stable, but when the patient is unstable and vasoconstricted, and when you are using vasodilators, it may not be accurate. When the patient is vasoconstricted or when we are using vasodilators.
Actually, if the patient is not hemodynamically stable, we do not go for non-invasive. We always go for invasive blood pressure monitoring.
Yes. They are more dependable. Invasive is more dependable when the patient is stable. Yes.
The most reliable is the cuff pressure, the oscillometric. Cuff pressure is the most reliable.
In case of non-invasive methods.
Correct. The cuff pressure measured by the blood pressure cuff is the most reliable.
Yeah, that's why the diagrams which I showed compare the invasive pressure with the cuff pressure. So, and when we start the case, we usually, it is a dictum to compare the invasive pressure with the non-invasive pressure and then go ahead with the case.
Thank you, sir.
And when you use the cuff, it should be the ideal size is 2/3 of the upper arm should be the measurement when you put it on.
Yes.
Sir, I had given all those guidelines in my slides.
It was mentioned by Radhika, yes.
So it has been given there. Excellent slides. Dr. Radhika.
Thank you so much, ma'am. In 6 days, sorry, I made one mistake in one slide.
Nobody realized it. Don't declare it.
No, yeah. In the chat box, people have asked.
Is it?
Pulse pressure.
It's good to know people are paying attention to the chat box.
They've not gone for dinner.
Any other question?
Any other question from anyone?
I'm really sorry about the technical difficulty I had when I started. I just did a good video recording, but last minute failed. But anyway, it's my pleasant duty to thank the panel, Dr. Manjula Sarkar, Dr. Kodan Ram, Dr. Chaitali Sen for conducting the program and being patient with me. Thank you so much. And I also like to thank Dr. Gurudat and Radhika for their excellent deliberations. And we will be doing this cardiovascular monitoring same webinars in next 2 to 3 webinars in the coming months. Please attend and also join us for the TE workshop. I would like to thank Dr. Radhakrishnan, Jayashri Sood, Baljit, Dr. Belani for being present in this webinar and making this activity a useful one. I think with this, I would like to conclude the session unless Dr. Radhakrishnan or Belani wants to say anything.
Sorry, I was busy today in the OT for a while. I joined as soon as I could. And it's whatever I heard was excellent. Great job you guys are doing.
Thank you. And Dr. Radhakrishnan is available. He wants to say anything.
Thank you.
Dr. Jayashree Sood, ma'am, is there. She wants to speak.
Dr. Jayashree, you want to say something?
Good evening, everybody. Dr. Muralidhar, you have thanked everybody, but I would like to thank you as well for the excellent webinar that was arranged. And thank you very much, moderators, Dr. Manjula, Dr. Kudandram, and Dr. Chaitali Sen. And thank you so much for sparing your time. The topic seemed such a basic one, but it was so important, and such valid points have been taken home from this, especially the students. They were so keen to attend this webinar. Unfortunately, as Dr. Murali said, that we were a little unlucky this time about the sound. It has never happened before, but I don't know what was the problem. But anyway, maybe, I don't know if we could do in the YouTube or something, probably have the proper sound, because some students might have missed out the more important points. So thanks a lot, Dr. Gurudhar, Dr. Radhika, Dr. Murali, for those excellent talks. And we'll be meeting next week. It's, I think the webinar is on neurosurgical anesthesia. Thank you very much, and good night.
Good night. Good night, and thank you.
Good night. Thanks, Rakesh. Thanks, Rakesh.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rakesh. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Rakesh.